Good morning, Cornerstone. Good morning. Come on now. Help me out. Welcome. Welcome to church. We are so spread out here. We've got the shaded section over here. We've got the sunny section. The smokers are in the back. Oh. Sorry, Karen. I wasn't talking about you. It's good to be in church. It's good to have you all here. It's good to have a great big blue sky. It's good to know that when we gather together, that the Lord is here in the midst of us. It says in Psalm 134, I sent this around to you this morning. It says, come bless God. Come bless God, all you servants of God, you priests of God posted to the night watch in God's shrine. Lift your praising hands to the holy place and bless God. In turn, may God of Zion bless you, the God who made heaven and earth. Would you join with me this morning? Let's pray together. I'm going to invite you to stand with me. And we're going to take a minute. We're just going to bless God as we begin. We're going to praise him for all of his blessings, all of his mighty acts, all of his great deeds. Praise him for salvation and his continued presence, his Holy Spirit. We got a lot to praise God for. Maybe you can praise God for some heat and just assume, Lord, it's coming. It's coming. Would you do something with me? Lift your hands with me. Let's praise him. Mighty God, we give you thanks for all that you do. You don't hold back anything from us. You pour out love and joy and favor and blessing all the time. We give you praise for all that you do in us. We bless you for this beautiful day, for the sunshine, the blue sky, and the green grass. I praise you for the Holy Spirit that's speaking to our heart and pulling us in deeper, speaking to us loud and clear. Lord, we love you. We give this time to you, and we ask you, Lord, that you would move in us, that, Lord, we would not be able to say that I left the same way I came in, but, Lord, that each one of us came in and we receive from Almighty God. And it's not like we walked out, but we floated out on cloud number 9, knowing that God is moving and doing good things in us. Speak to our hearts, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
I worship you, Almighty God. Oh,
gracious Lord, we magnify your name. We exalt you in this place, Jesus. Praise your name. Take for granted the freedom we have to come together and worship God, right? We were all apart for so long. In my heart, I was just like, God, I'm never going to take for granted getting together with my brothers and sisters and worshiping. And I just want to give him all that I have in worship, right? I'm sure you do too. We've waited for this day. We've gathered in your name. We're calling out to you. Your glory like a fire. Awakening desire will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart. Filling every heart of our praise.
Your presence in this place. Thank you, Father. Lord, we lift your name in this place. We worship you, Lord. We magnify you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, we welcome you here. Come and have your way amongst your people. Touch our hearts, oh God. Draw us closer to you, Lord. For you're worthy, Lord. You are worthy to be praised, no matter what we're going through, Lord. We just put everything to the side right now, Jesus. We focus and concentrate our hearts and our eyes on you, Lord.
Sing a new song.
Well, I guess I'm stuck in the shade. It's chilly up here. Again, Joanne, if you're done with your blankets, you just send it right up here. It's good to have you with us today. I love just seeing God's people, seeing the church, the Cornerstone, back together again. It was a long, long time to be apart, and it's good to be together. Just before we go to God's Word, can we do something together as a church? I know I just told you to sit down. I'm going to get you to stand up one more time. And what I want you to do, turn around, wave at somebody, do like an air shaking hands, air high five, fist bumps. You can pretend you're hugging somebody. You can hug your spouse if you want to. Welcome each other to church. And before you're seated, we're going to pray together. Because this week, our kids, our students are all going back to school on Thursday. I think the elementary school kids and high school grade, it's online learning, I think, on Thursday. And then the grade nines go back on Friday, and then everybody's back on Tuesday. And I imagine there's a great deal of anxiety for teachers, for parents, for kids going back. How are we going to get kindergartners to wear a mask all day long? That's going to be an interesting one, and not be swapping masks halfway through the day. So let's just take a moment as our church family to pray together. If you've got students in your family, maybe kids going back to elementary, high school, going back to university, speak their name out before the Lord. Put them out there. And teachers, we're praying for you as well. Let's just lift up all these folks as we head back to school this week. Mighty God, we give you thanks. That things are starting to turn around, Lord, and that we can get back to some semblance of normal. But Lord, as our kids go back to school, they've been out for 6 months, 7 months. And Lord, we just pray a blessing on them as they go. We pray for folks, everybody who's got a little bit of anxiety, some jitters, a little bit of discomfort about going back, a bit worried, Lord, about how the rules are changing and the regulations are happening. And we just pray for a great sense of calm and peace and joy in our school classrooms and hallways and playgrounds all week long. Lord, as the teachers get back and they're prepping their rooms, I pray they just notice that something special is going on, Lord, as you're speaking life into all these dead places. Father, I pray that as our kids go back, Lord, they would go back as boys and girls, as young men and women of God, that, Lord, they would hold strong to everything they know is true about your gospel, and that they would be a great influence everywhere they go in their classes this week, Jesus. Let them be a blessing to everybody and an encouragement as they go back. We just pray that the peace of God would reign supreme in Jesus' name. And all God's people, in one loud voice, join with me. Amen. Amen. You may be seated again. And you can stay there. You can stay there. Unless you got to go to the bathroom. Of course, you know where the bathroom is, but it's a really long walk back there. If we were thinking, we should have had like golf carts or something that could have, you know, valeted people to the washrooms. You'd see them as they go. So this week, of course, this week we're outdoors. Next week for Labor Day weekend, I'm going to encourage you not to come here. We're just going to do online services next week for the holiday weekend. And so join us online, and then we'll be back together the week after on September the 13th. So if you wouldn't mind, just turning to the person sitting next to you and say, don't come to church next week. You wear your pajamas. Meet me on the couch. We're going to be comfy with the cat. The dog's going to be there, and it's going to be good. All right. Cool. All right. Just next week only, then back to normal on the 13th. Parents, if you've got kids or young people living in your household, make sure you're signing up for to get onto the emails with our kids and our youth. You can follow the links from the email that went out this morning just to keep us moving together as we get back into the swing of things. I'm going to move up so these leaves aren't hitting my head again this week. This is, I'm like, feel like I'm preaching in the round today. I got 180 degrees to look. And so if I don't quite get to you, Vivian, all the time, I don't see you folks, don't hold it against me. It's just my head is going to get tired. It's moving this way, left to the right all morning. Did anybody here ever run away from home? when you're a kid, when you're young, Bob did. Yeah, Fred ran away from home. Not going back to Quebec. No, I'm moving to Ontario. Here to stay. You run away. I think everybody, when they're a child, they ran away at least once. You pack a bag full of, maybe you got a banana in there. Probably got a whole bunch of candy. You come home when you run out of clean underwear, or when the candy runs out, or maybe you just miss your mom and you got to get home. I never ran away once. I never even thought about running away because I had it way too good at home. I think I shared that with you earlier this summer that I was absolutely spoiled rotten. And my mom tends to watch our services. So mom, hi, how are you? Thank you very, very much. I appreciate it being spoiled all my entire life. I had it way too good at home. There's no way I was leaving. Now, I've learned that now that I have children of my own, I'm not doing that for them. If they want to run away, they can go. It'd be a whole lot cheaper, and it's good to know you guys. But I'm joking, Rob. I'm joking. Love you guys. Kids are expensive, though. Maybe they want to go like when it's expensive times. But I've never ran away from home. But one thing I've done a lot in my life is running away and running from God. You know, we distinctly hear God's voice calling to us and leading us in a certain direction. And man, it's way too easy to nope that sometimes and to say, God, I definitely hear you. God, I definitely hear your voice and know that that's you and know that it's happening, but I'm not doing that. I don't think so. I'm not doing that. I remember when I was young, I really felt strongly. I felt led that God wanted me to be a pastor. And I thought, oh, that's cool. Until I got a little bit older and realized, no, I don't want to be a pastor. That doesn't sound like fun at all. I want to go and do something that's going to be a lot of fun. And I didn't have a whole lot of fun. I have actually a whole lot more fun now. I wish I just listened to God in the first place. I would have saved myself a lot of money and a lot of time. When we run from God, we're basically telling the Lord, God, I know better. I know better than you. I know what's up with my life. I know what's happening. I know what's best. I just want to communicate to you that I think you're awesome, but not so awesome in this area. And that's kind of a big thing to say to a God who made us, who created us, who put our pieces together, who holds us together on a daily basis. And when we say nope to God, man, we're putting ourselves in a pretty sticky situation. You know, like we may run from God for a while, but the moment things start to get difficult, like the moment that there might be like a negative phone call or a bad report at the doctor, well, we're back in a hurry and we're saying, God, I want you to look after my thing and I want you to solve my problem. But like this stuff back here, don't go near that. Let's just focus on the problem, God, and let's deal with what I need you to deal with. I'll come back halfway, but I don't know. I don't think I'm definitely not coming back the whole way. I just don't know, God, if I can do what you're asking. It's too big. It's too tall. And we can think about the things that maybe God has asked you to do. Maybe God has been pushing on kind of sensitive areas in your life. Maybe he's called you out of sin at times in your life. And you know, I definitely shouldn't be doing that. I definitely shouldn't have that attitude. I definitely shouldn't be going there. And God's saying, well, why go there? Why don't you do something different? Why don't you stay away from those people that cause you to sin? Oh, but God, those people are pretty cool. I kind of want to be around them, or I want to go to that place, or I want to do that thing. And I'm not sure if I want to cut it out of my life. Of course, the most famous person in the Bible that's known for running is, of course, nobody knows. One person, Barb. Thank you, Barb. Jonah, read your Bibles, guys. He's a minor prophet. Big fish, big storm. He got mad at God because God wanted him to do something really good. Jonah was a prophet. Prophets are raised up, called by God to go and speak a really unpopular message to people who are going astray. Now, Jonah would look at maybe some of the other prophets of Israel and say, well, you guys had it easy because you're just called to go to Israel. But some of them had tall jobs. They had some pretty crazy callings. I think about the call maybe that God has on your life and the call that God has on my life and the things that God has asked us to do. I don't think God has ever called you to do what he called Hosea to do. Hosea was called by God to marry a woman who would absolutely cheat on him. That's crazy. I don't know if I want to go down that road, but God called Hosea to do that, to prove a point to the people of Israel. And he also wanted Hosea, get this, I don't know if you know this, but Hosea had two kids. I think our kids, Rob and Shar, I like those names. I think those are pretty good names. Hosea was called by God to call his kids not my people and unloved. Can you imagine calling them for dinner? Not my people. Not my people and unloved. You guys come to the table. Yeah, that's not cool. The prophet Ezekiel laid on his left side, specifically his left side, for 390 days to signify the 390 years that Israel had been living in sin. Are you glad that God has not called you to do that? Yes. Although, if you had a waterbed, remember waterbeds way back in the day, maybe that wouldn't be such a bad thing. Oh, Isaiah, this is kind of nasty. Isaiah was called to preach naked for 3 years. Don't even start thinking, because it's not a good thing to think. Nobody's going to that church. Nobody at all is ever. Could you imagine inviting somebody to come to? No, I'm not going to your church. No way. No way. But these guys were called to Israel, and Israel was a people that knew God and had a relationship with God. And Jonah would say, you guys got it made in the shade. Easy peasy. This is just a piece of pie. There's nothing difficult to this. Because Jonah was called to a people who had no idea who God was. They had no respect for him. They had no, there's no identity, no relationship. And Jonah was called to these people that lived in a city called Nineveh. And these were pretty wicked people. These were people that were professionals at sinning. They were just really good at it. And God called Jonah to go there right out of the blue and to say, you guys are messing up. You guys are doing wrong, and God in heaven is going to bring judgment on you unless you repent. So if you want to follow along with me, I'm going to be in Jonah chapter 1, but I'm going to be reading it as well. So Jonah chapter 1, verse 1 says, the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, and he said, go to the great city of Nineveh, and I want you to preach against it because its wickedness has come up before me. And Jonah kind of wanted nothing to do with that. He didn't think that sounded like a whole lot of fun. Could you imagine going to the biggest city in the known world and telling them that you guys honestly, you stink. You're bad. You're worse than bad. You're just awful. And God's going to do wrong stuff and bad stuff all about you. I think, God, let's just skip the warning. Let's go right to judgment. Let's skip the meal, get right to dessert. I think you should just smush them right now. And Jonah noped it pretty quick. He shook his head. I don't think so. He still believed in God. He wasn't jettisoning his faith, but he just wasn't going to do what God wanted him to do. So it says, as we continue, Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, and he found a ship that was bound for that port. And after paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from God. So when Jonah runs, he really, really runs. Nineveh was like 900 kilometers away. That's like a one day's drive. I don't know what that translates to camel hours, but it wasn't that far away. And he said, I'm going to Tarshish, which we're not completely sure where Tarshish was. It could have been Spain. It could have been England. For our purposes, he was going about as far as he possibly could in the other direction. There's no way, God, I am doing what you want me to do. I'm not going in that direction. I don't think so. And I look at my life, and maybe you can think of your life as well, and you can think, yep, I kind of understand, I empathize, I'm there, I get that. God, you want me to do something, you want me to go somewhere, you want me to speak to this friend or speak to that neighbor. God, you want me to start to tithe. God, you want me to be generous wherever I go with everything that I've gotten. I'm going to nope that pretty quick, and I'm going to run in the complete opposite direction. We still love God. We're still moving. Well, I guess we're not moving in God's direction anymore, but we still are kind of a godly person. We just don't want to do what God wants us to do. And I think every one of us has been there at some point in our life. Maybe we're there right now in a spot where we know God is inviting us to do something and we're just doing the opposite. I thought as I was putting this some of these thoughts together and as writing my notes up, kind of a professional myself at running. No, not running. I don't jog because I think that's crazy. I don't understand people that run. If you're running and there's not somebody chasing you, I don't get it. And there's a lot of people nodding. Yeah, I get that too. But as a runner myself, running from God, I have a lot of experience with this. And God, I know you're calling me, but I don't think I want to do that. I don't think that's the best thing for me. Yeah, try telling that to God. But speaking as a runner, I find that when people run from God, they tend to run to some pretty strange places. Maybe you know somebody who's done this, that they've turned tail and run from God, and they've gone and got married all of a sudden. They married the absolute wrong person, and you're just, oh, man, you got to be kidding me. And you're just kind of shaking your head. I can't believe they did that. Or maybe that person, they went and they spent a pile of money on something. What in the world are they thinking? Man, that's crazy. I would never, ever do that. When people run from God, they tend to run to strange places because they're running away from the source of wisdom. Can somebody please say amen to that? We run from God. Whoever that was really loud. I really appreciate that. That made me feel great. Because when we run from God, if God is our guidepost, God is our direction, God is our leader, we're losing it. We're losing focus. We're losing direction. We're losing our idea of what to do next. We are running away from God's wisdom. And in Jonah chapter 1, verse 4, God just kind of steps in and it says, then the Lord. And I imagine as I'm reading the Bible that, you know, it's like that big movie trope where then the Lord, dun, dun, dun. And the bass kicks up, and you know that this is not going to go good for Jonah. And all of us who have graduated from Sunday school in our childhood, we know what's coming next because the teacher's going to put that flannel graph whale up on the board, and this story is going south really fast. Then the Lord, and the runners eventually are going to have these dun-dun-duns come up in their life. So then the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. All the sailors were afraid, and each cried out to their own God, and they began to throw cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. Jonah went down below deck where he lay, and he fell into a deep sleep. Gee, thanks, buddy. And the captain went to him and said, how in the world can you sleep? Get up and call on your God. Maybe, just maybe, he will take notice of us so that we will not perish. Can I suggest to you that runners are the last person to make the connection between what's happening in their life and what they think is going on? When you tend to run from God or move in a direction that is opposite to God and things start to go south, you rarely connect the dots that things might be going south because I'm not walking in the favor of the Lord anymore. I'm not moving with Him. I'm not leaving with His blessing. I'm walking on my own and I'm walking in the strength that I've got. Now, we see this really clearly in other people. I know some people, you know, you might be sitting here thinking, man, I wish so-and-so were here to hear this. This is a message for them. And I love getting those emails from people who email after church, and they say, was the service recorded? Because I know somebody who really needs to hear this. And we're all in that boat where we can think of somebody, you know, this is really applicable for them. It's really easy to see problems in other people's lives, but man, it's hard to diagnose them for ourselves. It's hard to point out our flaws. I mean, your spouse is really good, and that's why you married them, just so you know what's wrong. But it's hard to see them in me. I look in the mirror, man, I look fantastic. I wake up in the morning, my bed head looks better than most people's real heads. It's just fantastic. Everything is good. Everything is bright and sunny and roses and daisies and moonbeams and unicorn dust and all the rest. But we don't see problems in ourselves. We see them in other people pretty fast. Those of you that, you know, you had kids and your kids were young, and even at a young age, they're starting to assert their independence and they want to do their own thing. Maybe you had a little one who wanted to wear high heeled shoes and walk up and down the stairs. You know it's not going to go well, and you know it's not going to work out for them. You know they're going to end up in a pile at the bottom of the stairs. Isn't that right, Charlotte? It's easy to see that in others. And you can look at your kids, you can say, holy cow, you guys are missing the mark. You guys are going, if you would just do what I'm telling you to do, because I can see the problem in you so clearly, but it is so hard to see all the problems in me. It's hard to see that I am going wrong. Jonah, laying down there in the belly of the boat, he is completely oblivious to the storm that's around him. He sees no connection between the storm and what's happening in his own life. The ship's captain invites him to come up for a prayer meeting. What's going on? I don't need to pray. This isn't my problem. And Jonah wipes the sleep from his eyes and he joins in. The sailors, they said to each other in verse 10, come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity. And they cast lots and the lot fell to Jonah. Can I just say, this is not a great spiritual principle. Don't gamble over, you know, trying to find out what to do next. Just trust God, okay? Can we just all agree and say amen? Let's just trust God. Don't gamble with your future. The casino's closed anyway. Good job, God. Good job. So they cast lots, and the lot fell to Jonah, and they asked him, tell us, who is responsible for making all this trouble for us? What kind of work do you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? From what people are you? And he answered, I'm a Hebrew, and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the dry land and the sea. Yeah, that's my God. And this terrified them, and they asked, what in the world have you done? They knew that he is running away from the Lord because he had already told them so. The sea was getting rougher and rougher, so they asked him, what should we do to you to make the sea calm down for us? Because honestly, we're going to do absolutely anything. If we got to beat you up, that's what we'll do, anything it takes to make this storm go away. And Jonah says, pick me up and throw me into the sea. And it'll get calm. I know it's my fault and that this storm has come upon you. So they took Jonah, they threw him overboard, and the raging sea grew calm. At this, the men greatly feared the Lord, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord, and they made vows to him then and there. I promise I'll never do anything wrong as long as I live for the rest of my life. And then the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights. And I like this. Verse 1 of chapter 2 says, from inside the fish, Jonah did what? He prayed. Oh, you better believe it. He was praying like crazy, and he was fasting because there's no way you're eating anything that's inside that fish. But he was praying his heart out, praying his guts out. He wasn't holding anything out from God. And in that moment, Jonah discovered something that each of us, we learn and we discover eventually, but we wish we had learned sooner, that you cannot outrun God. You can certainly run from him, but you will never outrun him. The crazy thing is, and I mean, this blows my mind. Every time I consider, like every time I sin and go wrong, every time I lose my cool, every time something goes difficult in my life that's my fault, I come back to God and God still loves me. Blows me away. I can't wrap my head around it that God loves me every time, even though I'm sinning. And I can do the same sin, and you can do the same thing day in, day out, day in, day out. You can still come to God, and he still loves you and still welcomes you back, still invites you back into that close relationship. You can run from God, but man, you can't outrun him. And I think that's just the hugest blessing that we can hold on to, that the Lord doesn't get so mad at us that he's just going to flick us off the face of the earth or squish us like a bug. He's not going to take it out on us. He wants to welcome us back into relationship, and that's what everything is all about. And I don't think necessarily that God is chasing us and hounding us down, but he'll wait for us to come back. Sometimes it takes sitting in the belly of a fish for 3 days. Sometimes it takes living in the wilderness for a lot of years. But even so, God is moving pieces. God is setting things in order. God is making it possible for you to come back to him. Now this fish, this must have been a mammoth fish, because I've seen some of the fish that, like, you guys catch. They're not that big. I got like all the fishermen. I shouldn't have said that. Fishermen hate me now. But this must have been a massive fish. This was not a normal fish. This wasn't like your normal walleye or your pickerel you're catching. This is something supernatural that God put in place, that God put in order, that God had appear just at the right time. It's a storm that God caused to stir up because he wanted to get Jonah's attention. And as we look through the Bible, we see story after story after story of times when God moved heaven and earth to make sure that people found their way back to him. And even you think of your story, all the things that had to fall into place for you to get to where you are today. That there was somebody else who had to be saved and somebody else who had to know about Jesus. Somebody else who had to be filled with the Spirit to meet you in a specific spot so that they could tell you about Jesus in the middle of very specific circumstances in your life. And you found your way to God, not on your own, but because the Holy Spirit was calling you and inviting you to come close. See, none of us are even here because, like here today for this service, because we planned it or we set our alarm clock, but the Holy Spirit called us and beckoned us and invited us to come near. All through Scripture, we see that God is moving, leading, God is guiding and calling, speaking out our name, inviting us to come close. In Proverbs chapter 3, now this is kind of a verse that, like, it's one of those ones in the Bible that I don't know if I like it. I don't think it feels great. But after you mull it over and let it roll around your head for a bit, yeah. Yeah, that's a huge blessing. It says, my child, because God invites us to know him as Father. That's the one name we didn't cover, one name of many we didn't cover in the Hello, My Name is God series, is God comes to us as Abba, Father, invites us to call him Dad. And he calls us his children. He says, my child, don't reject God's discipline. And don't be upset when he corrects you. Because God corrects those that he loves. He's not going to be out there trying to get you. He's not out to punish you. And I don't know where that comes from, that God is angry at us. We've been talking in our small group that each one of us have felt that one point in our life that God was angry at us. That God was out to get us, that God wanted harm from us or to take away all of our fun. But we learned as we got close that God had blessing for us. The Lord corrects those that he loves, just as a father corrects a child in whom he delights. And so God chases down Jonah, calls his name to bring him back into alignment, to get him back to the place where Jonah can receive blessing and favor and joy for his life. There's no joy in running. There's no happiness in running. But peace and contentment, we know, is found only in Jesus. This morning, just as we wrap up, two things we're going to be praying for. Number one, I know there's people here today. There's got to be folks that are feel God calling them to do something, and you're going the other direction. You might not be running all the way to Tarshish, but you're running in one way or another, and God is calling you and inviting you to get back in line. So we're going to pray for you. Also, we're going to pray for people who should be here today. People who walked away from God, or maybe people that used to serve God, maybe people in your family, children, brothers, sisters, who are away from God, but really should be in the family of God. And God has not forgotten about them at all. He's got his finger on them. He's calling them just like he calls you, inviting them to come close just like he invites you. So as we pray today, would you stand with me one more time? This is the last time today. It's going to, you know, it sometimes is up and down a lot. Just be glad you're not you're not Catholic, because, man, they're really up and down, on their knees, back up to your seat, standing up again. Father in heaven, we give you thanks. God, I can't believe that you call and you call my name over and over and over again. You are so patient with me. And you're the same with everybody here, with all of us, Lord. We don't have to be good. We don't have to put everything perfect in our lives. We don't have to get all of our ducks in a row, Lord. All we got to do is hear your voice. All we got to do is hear you calling our name, and we know, Lord, that you're inviting us to get back in alignment with you. Father, speaking as a former runner today, I thank you, Lord, that you call us back on track and get us moving in your direction. Father, for the runners who are here today, people who distinctly know, yep, I'm going in the wrong direction. I feel God calling me to do this, and I've been doing that. I've said nope to God. I've shook my head. I've tried to convince him to do other ways. Lord, I pray you'd reach out to each individual. Pull them back into the right direction. Speak life to the dead areas of their heart that's pulling them off course, and lead them back to do your way and your thing, and to receive blessing and honor and favor from their Heavenly Father. Today also, Lord, we want to pause and we want to lay all of those people who should be in the family of God at your feet. People that came through the Sunday school here at our church. People that attended youth group. People that were a part of small groups, or people that came to Sunday services, Lord. People that have walked away from God for whatever reason. God, I pray for them, and Lord, we call them out by name. And Lord, we invite you to keep calling them, and I know you do. And I pray you'd bring them back into alignment. Bring them back into a good spot. Bring them back into the family of God where they can receive from you and hear from you and grow in you and be fulfilled by you in every area of their lives. Father, I pray that you wouldn't hold back, but that you'd keep calling. Lord, you're a patient God. Keep being patient. You're a faithful God. Keep being faithful. And Lord, we'll celebrate as we see people returning to the family of God. We'll celebrate, Lord, as we see people's lives being changed and brought back with you as their focus. Father, as we leave today, I know, I don't need to pray for it, because I know you're leaving with us. You're going ahead of us. You're making our way straight. You're preparing our path. Lord, I know that you're already doing that. I pray, Lord, in our hearts we would know that, God, you're with us, that your Spirit would be speaking loud and clear to our heart and pulling us ever tighter, ever closer into your family. Father, be with us as we go. Let us walk out of here with your blessings, with a bounce in our step and a big goofy grin on our face, because we know that God is doing good things. Lord, we bless you today and always in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you, Cornerstone. Good to be with you. Great to see you. Can't wait to see you go. So we can be together again. Next week, we're online, of course, and then the week after, we'll be back together. God bless you guys.